فَمَنِ اتَّقَى وَأَصْلَحَ فَلَا خَوْفٌ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا هُمْ يَحْزَنُونَ.
بسم الله الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله أما بعد السلام على من اتبع الهدى. There are a few preliminary things I have to mention here so that you guys will understand what I'm trying to do here and go away with a message that is clear. So the first thing is that in actuality, when I was invited to give this lecture, the topic was given to me. And I was told that the targeted audience were going to be nonsense. So I should gear the talk towards addressing the minds of nonsense. I didn't necessarily agree with that because it is an important topic that Muslims themselves need to understand. So for those of you who are Muslims, this is just as important to you as a message as it is for those people who the topic was originally created for. Second thing is, during the course of the lecture, you're going to hear me use some Arabic phrases. I won't use those Arabic phrases to alienate you or to mesmerize you, but in order to translate verses of the Quran, in order to translate the statements and the sayings of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, as a speaker, I have to say it in Arabic so that I can get a mental picture of what I'm about to translate. If I just try to translate it without saying in Arabic, I'm going to chop up the text. And I don't want to do that. And another issue about the Arabic is, as a Muslim, even a Muslim who is a nominal Muslim and is not really practicing, but a Muslim who's practicing his religion, part of his life, his whole life is Islam, so what happens is he's going to always use Arabic phrases for everyday mundane things, like the word inshallah. He's going to always say inshallah, if Allah wills. When Prophet Muhammad's name is mentioned, out of respect to him, reverence towards him, the Muslim, when he hears his name, he says sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, peace and blessings of Allah be upon him. So I'll do my best not to say things in Arabic. I'll do my best, but the verses of the Quran and the statements of Prophet Muhammad and mentioning his name, I'm going to say sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, I'm going to speak in Arabic. So you just try to bear with me if I mention some things in Arabic and you feel you're lost and it's not from the translation of the Quran, but I'll do my best. As it relates to the topic, Islam, freedom or oppression, and the first piece of information that I want to share with you is the fact that in Islam, Prophet Muhammad is the example for us. He is the one who's going to determine and he's the one who's going to define. Unfortunately, and I'm speaking from experience and from reality, I'm a revert to this religion. So my mother, my father were not Muslims. I was not raised in a Muslim country. I reverted to the religion, came back to the religion on my own accord after studying and being convinced. When I came into the religion and I started to meet Muslims from different nationalities and different backgrounds, they confused me. And that's because today, especially the way Muslims are practicing and understanding the religion of Islam, the non-Muslim who's looking in from without is going to be confused about Islam. We don't give people a good understanding of what our religion is. And that's why I repeat over and over and over to non-Muslim audiences, the Muslim community has a great level of responsibility to show Islam. But anyone who's looking for real Islam, don't look at the Muslims. Don't look at the Muslims, it's just like Christianity. I'm not going to look at Christians to understand Christianity. I'm not going to do that. You have to look at the text of Islam and you'll get a good understanding. So Prophet Muhammad, He is the one who gives us definitions. He is the one who is the example for us. And the Quran is replete with many, many verses that make that clear. Like the statement of Allah in the Quran, لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنًا. Allah said to our community, to mankind, you have in Prophet Muhammad a perfect example. And that's a general verse. Perfect example as it relates to a husband, a father, as it relates to a leader, as it relates to whatever. He's a perfect example. So a Muslim is going to learn about his life, the life of Muhammad, peace and blessings of Allah be upon him, in order to navigate throughout his life. He is never going to take his religious teacher as the example. The leader of his country is not the example. The president of his country, whether it's a Muslim country or other than that, they are not the example for us. My mother and my father, who I love dearly, they're not Muslims, and Islam did not tell me that I can't love, honor, and respect them. If they said things or did things that went against Islam, went against what Prophet Muhammad said, my loyalty lies with Prophet Muhammad. That's why I'm Muslim. So he's the example. Now, the reason why I'm saying that is we have to deal with this issue of the definition of freedom or the concept of freedom in Islam. Because there are two extremes that we have to make it clear. Two extremes, freedom in Islam. So one of the responsibilities that Prophet Muhammad had, like all of his brothers from the prophets and the messengers, is that they were sent, and I'm speaking strictly from the theology of Islam, obviously. So what I'm saying in this presentation is some speech that you have to look at, understand it, get your head around it from the prism of Islam. I'm speaking as a Muslim from the Islamic sources. Prophet Muhammad and his brothers, the other prophets and messengers, one of the main reasons why they were sent is to be the example. They were the ones who spoke on behalf of the Almighty Creator. Because if it was left up to each and every individual to understand and to determine, then there's going to be confusion and anarchy. Because people are different in their makeup, in their understanding, in the purity and the dirt and all of that. People are different. Prophet Muhammad is the one in our religion where everyone has to get behind what he said and understand it the way he said and what he meant. And this happened with many of his companions where he explained to them and clarified for them things that they understood one way, but he said, no, the correct way to understand that thing in Islam is this way. I can give you a number of examples, but I'll give you two very quickly. So the point here is, Prophet Muhammad is the one who defines what freedom is. Prophet Muhammad is the one who defines what oppression is. Because again, he's the prophet. And it's his job and his responsibility to explain to people what God wants them to do and what God meant by this and what God meant by that. I'll give you an example. Prophet Muhammad said to his companions and he said to our community by default, أَتَدْرُونَ مَنَ الْمُفْلِسِ. Do you people know who the bankrupt person is? Do you know who the bankrupt person is? They said, yes, Messenger of Allah, the bankrupt person to us is the one who doesn't have any money and he doesn't have any property. That's going to be the answer of almost everybody from every single culture, from every single country, from every walk of life. The bankrupt person is the one who doesn't have any wealth. He doesn't have any property to use as collateral, property to sell and to get money. He files chapter 11 to protect his property. That's the bankrupt person. That was the understanding of the people. He said, no, the bankrupt person from our ummah in this religion, the bankrupt person is the one who comes Yawm al-Qiyamah, and Yawm al-Qiyamah is the day of judgment, the last day. The one who comes on the last day and he has a lot of prayers that he made. He paid a lot of his wealth to the poor. He fasts a lot. He has a lot of fasts under his belt. During the course of his life, he did a lot of good deeds. But during the course of his life, he shed the blood of this individual. He stole the money of that individual. He oppressed this one. And he gave some examples of the mistakes that people make and the oppression that people met out against others. He says, so as a result of that, all of the good things that he did during his life, those people have to be paid back. They have to get their just due. This man oppressed them. People are living life right now and they're being killed and everyone dies and the murderer, nothing happens to him. He killed all of those people. All of those people being killed in Iraq senselessly. They're innocent. Everybody dies and that's it. No, people have to be held accountable. So he said that person who did all of the fasting and all of the praying and all of the things that he did that are good, those people that he oppressed, his good deeds are going to be given to them. His good deeds will be given to them. And if his good deeds are exhausted and there are no more good deeds to be given, but there are still people who are in line that he owes, then their bad deeds will be thrown on him. So this particular incident is an incident that shows Prophet Muhammad explained to the people the concept of bankruptcy. It doesn't mean that the other bankruptcy, that's not true. It doesn't mean that, but real bankruptcy. So it helps the person who may be a Muslim and he doesn't have a lot of money. He knows that being rich is not the key to success. It's not the measurement of success in of Islam. That story, that hadith, that statement helps a person understand that as well. Okay, I don't have a lot of money. I don't have a lot of money, but I know people who have a lot of money and they're not happy. And I know people who have a lot of money and they have a lot to answer for as it relates to the money that they receive. But the reason that I'm mentioning this to you is to share with you, to show with you, Prophet Muhammad defined for the people what the meaning of that thing was. Another hadith, another example, is that there was an individual during his time. He was a very muscular man, and he was a good wrestler, and his bodily prowess struck fear in the hearts of people who saw him. Like some of the people we see walking around in society, when you see that, people tend to be afraid and they don't want to tangle with that individual. So Prophet Muhammad wanted the people to understand a very important point, that you can't always judge things by their appearance. So he said to the people, he said, being strong is not the one who can out-wrestle everyone. He said, that's not the strong one. He said, being strong is the individual who can control his anger. That's the one who's strong. So a man can have a lot of muscles, but that doesn't make him a man. That doesn't make him a person who has a lot of strength. And then the other person can be a puny individual with no muscles, but they can control themselves. They know how to behave and know how to deal with situations. So the people had an idea that strength is defined in a person's masculinity and his ability to out-wrestle you, to throw you on the ground. He said, that's not the strong one in our religion. The strong one in our religion is the one who has the ability to control himself. Now, I'm not here to explain the details of that, but again, as Muslims, this is really important because, again, it helps us to understand that we shouldn't overemphasize issues like that. We should put more emphasis on issues like being people who know how to deal with people in a nice way. So the reason why I mentioned that is like the first example, Prophet Muhammad gave an explanation and a definition, and that's what we understand. And there are many examples of that, many, many, many examples. Just to give you one more, I give you one more. There are a number of them, but just one more. There was a man during his time who was a Christian. He was an Arab Christian. When he met Muhammad, Muhammad started to call him to Islam. The man accepted Islam. The people from his tribe, because he was the leader, they accepted Islam. So while they were spending time with Prophet Muhammad in this particular place, some verses of the Quran were revealed about their situation. one of the verses that was revealed is the statement of Allah, اتخذوا أحبارهم رهبانهم أربابا من دون الله. This man who was a Christian, Allah said in this verse, this man was a Christian, and the people with him, they took their priests and their monks as lords, gods, along with Allah. When that man heard that verse, and he's a Muslim now, he said, hey, Messenger of Allah, we didn't worship our monks and our priests. We didn't worship them. Prophet Muhammad said to the man, didn't those monks and priests, they took your book, they took your holy book, and in your book there were things that were permissible in the book, but they made those things impermissible? The man said, yes. He said, didn't those preachers, those monks, those priests, those leaders, didn't they take your book? And there were things in the book which were the opposite. They were, in one case, permissible, and they made them not permissible, and then they made some things that were not permissible, they made them permissible. He said, yes. He said, then that was the worship that you did to those people, because only God has the right to make things permissible and not permissible. So the man, this is the point, that Christian man who had became a Muslim, he thought worship was prostrating to people. That's what he thought worship was. Worship was reverencing the one who you're worshiping and you're afraid. That's what he thought it was. Prophet Muhammad told him, in this case, worship is if God said, do this particular thing. Human beings don't have the right to come and say, we're not going to do that thing, we're going to do the opposite. Like my mother, my family are really committed and dedicated Christians, and I'm not here to bash Christianity or Judaism or anything other than that, I'm just sharing something with you. And they raised us as Christians, but we used to eat pork. Although in our book that we had and we believed in, pork is clearly something that's not permissible to be eaten in the Bible, Old Testament and New Testament. But the people came now and said, no, that's the old thing. Now this is the new thing. So those were some of the issues that used to present themselves to me that would make me say, hey, we're doing this thing the way we want. There's no guidelines. There are no guidelines. And there are many examples like that with my own family. Things that the Bible said that we don't do, or we don't believe in. The Torah is like that, and the Bible is like that. So my point here is, Prophet Muhammad, he's the one who clarifies for us what is freedom and what is slavery. And it's not permissible, and it's not acceptable, it's not fair, it's not intelligent for people to be arrogant. And we find this thing in the West, we find this thing in America. When we look at other people's cultures, like Africa, for an example, we would describe Africans as being people who are not civilized, for an example. Or in the case of Prophet Muhammad, he married one of his wives who was very young. She was very young. So we, in our arrogance, we want to superimpose our norms, our way of life on other people. And then we come and we are judgmental. When in fact, if people were to look at Western civilization the way we live, there are a lot of things that we're doing that are very uncivilized. So it's not fair for any group of people to come and to do that to other people. Just superimpose what they think is right or wrong, unless the thing is a universally understood issue, is right, is wrong. So my mother, again, when I became a Muslim, she found out that Prophet Muhammad had married a young woman, and she brought that to the table, and she wanted to know, what about this? Because in her attempts to try and understand Al-Islam, the first thing she was introduced to were those ambiguous issues that people misunderstand about Islam. So she began to ask me. I didn't really want to talk about that because it's not the most important message of Al-Islam, but she put pressure on me. And it was strange, because I said to her, my answer to you, ma, concerning that question and that concern of yours, thanks, man, shukran, Akhi-san, is that your own mother, my grandmother, your own mother, who comes from Raleigh, North Carolina, your own mother. She got married to my grandfather, my mother's father, at the age of 13. And that was something normal and natural at that time. So whatever you have to say concerning Muhammad, anyway, you're feeling uptight, then my grandfather, my grandmother, your mother, your father, they did the same thing. When she looked at it from that context, she embraced it. Because if you're going to say he molested the young girl and so on, then that same ruling has to apply to my grandmother and my grandfather. My mother's not going to say that because that wasn't the case. But they lived in an environment, they lived in a way that was acceptable for that time and so forth. So now when it comes to this issue of freedom, what did Muhammad say freedom was? What does the Quran say freedom is? What is the understanding of freedom? Freedom in al-Islam is what I would call in Arabic an ubudiyya. For those of you who are Muslims, you should write this word down, add this word to the many vocabulary words that you have in the Arabic dictionary, because your vocabulary has to continuously grow. It's part of just being a Muslim. So one of the most important words in al-Islam is this issue, an ubudiyya. The meaning of ubudiyya is servitude, a person being a slave to God Almighty, meaning slave, he believes in God, and after believing in God, Allah is going to do his level best to practice what he perceives as a Muslim. God wants me to do this, he wants me to do that, he doesn't want me to do this, he doesn't want me to do that, so I'm going to do my best. I have to pray 5 times a day. I have to pray 5 times a day. That's servitude. My body, it is a trust that's been given to me. When I die, I have to be a person who's able to say, I took care of it to the best of my ability. So I didn't drink. So I didn't get high. I didn't put tattoos on my body. I didn't alter my body, except in the ways that Islam said was permissible. Al-Ubudiyya. This is freedom in al-Islam. This is what the Quran gives us, and this is what Prophet Muhammad taught us. Freedom in al-Islam is not being able to say what you want to say, drink what you want to drink, eat what you want to eat, wear what you, this is not freedom in al-Islam. As a matter of fact, people were like that, and people live like that. People throw caution to the wind, do whatever you want to do. These people are actually in slavery in al-Islam, as you're going to see as we move forward. So freedom in al-Islam, based on the Quran, based upon what Prophet Muhammad said, is servitude. Not having a problem, realizing I'm a human being, although there are many things about human beings that are very positive, but that positive thing about human beings comes from the one who created them. So all of the glory and all of the praise goes back to him. All of the acknowledgement goes back to him. So any human being that excelled in this life and he was responsible for creating or inventing something that people point their finger at him, he becomes famous for that. We're going to acknowledge what he did and we're going to praise him for what he did. But we're going to say you would not have been able to do that had it not been for God Almighty. So all of the praise ultimately goes to God. Goes to Allah, not having a problem with that. So the Quran has established that the best people that we perceive as being the examples, as I mentioned, the prophets and the messengers, they didn't have any problem with being slaves to Allah, servants of Allah. Many verses give us that. Like what Allah said about Jesus Christ in the Quran. There's a verse when he said, لن يستنكف المسيح أن يكون عبدا لله ولا الملائكة المقربون ومن يستنكف عن عبادته ويستكبر فإنه فسيحشرهم إليه جميعا. Allah said in describing the Messiah, Jesus Christ, Jesus didn't have any problem with being the slave of Allah, the servant of Allah. He didn't say he was the son of Allah, according to Muslims. He didn't tell the people, worship me. Jesus, the Messiah, he didn't have any problem with being the slave of Allah. Nor do the angels who are close to Allah have any problem with being his servants. And anyone who has a problem with being his servant and they're arrogant, Allah is going to return them back to him, and then he's going to deal with the situation. So in the Islamic narrative, the best people are those prophets and messengers who came to show people how to worship Allah. And none of them had a problem with being slaves. One man came to Prophet Muhammad and he started praising him, blowing smoke in his ear, trying to blow his head up, making him bigger than who he was. And he started saying to him, showering him with so many accolades and so many words of praise. Prophet Muhammad told that man, don't say that. I'm just Abdullah and Rasulullah. I'm just the slave of Allah and the messenger of Allah. Yes, I'm a prophet, I'm a messenger. It makes me not ordinary, but nonetheless, I'm a human being and I'm a slave. He didn't allow people to raise him up. Being in Al-Islam since 1986, I met a lot of people, travel all over the world. I met a lot of people, a lot of Muslims, especially people in positions like I'm in right now. People who give talks, people who like the scholar, the sheikh, the one who is teaching. And I've met some people from Islam. I'm not putting Muslims down, but I'm sharing something with it because this problem permeates everywhere. I met some people in the position that I'm in, and you have to do everything for them. You have to get them coffee. You have to make sure they're very comfortable. They open up the door for them, everything. And many of those people take advantage of the other people. Preachers do that, priests do that, rabbis do that. And if the member of the community doesn't have a good grip and a good understanding, connection between his own personal relationship with God, easy. He's taking advantage of. Easily. In Al-Islam, Prophet Muhammad warned the people, don't be like that. Don't be a person who you allow your intellect to be put asleep and you do something that normally you wouldn't do it because of the religion. I bring your attention to what happened in Guyana, a few years ago. It was in the 80s, I believe. There was a crackpot preacher by the name of Jimmy Jones. He was in Guyana. And a lot of people went and followed him there from America. Many of them were African Americans. But the people seemed to have gotten along, you know, very well amongst themselves. So the American government, they sent a senator down there to check on what was going on because they heard that it was a cult and maybe American lives were under siege and under threat. The senator arrived, he saw it, he was impressed with what was going on. Their compound, the commune, the way it was a rainbow coalition type thing going on. The man was impressed. For some reason, when he was leaving and he got on the plane to leave, for some reason, that man, Jimmy Jones, he sent some of his henchmen and he shot the senator up and the people with the senator. Now they know. American government is going to come and get us. He gathered up all of the people in the compound and he told them, Armageddon is here. Armageddon is here. So he made a concoction of Kool-Aid laced with cyanide. And he told the people to drink it. Something like 800 people drank the Kool-Aid. Now how in the world would you allow yourself, you, people out here? If I was there, this is my brother, this is my cousin, that's my wife over there, those are my children, and we believe in this man. But when I hear him say, hey, Armageddon is here, we have to drink cyanide and kill ourselves, I'm going to say to my wife and my kids, hey guys, listen up. Pour the Kool-Aid on the side, don't let anybody see you, we're gonna just play dead. But what happens is, again, this is the point, when you suspend your intellect because of religion, it's a problem. It's a problem. So Prophet Muhammad and all of his brothers from the prophets and the angels, they have no problem with being the slave of Allah, meaning you're not Allah, you're not Allah. Yes, they're messengers, so they have that level above normal people. But nonetheless, They don't deserve to be worshipped. Because the human being is susceptible to so many things. And from those things, he dies. And anything that dies doesn't deserve to be God. So freedom in Al-Islam is for a person to submit his will willingly. He makes a conscious decision in the religion to be a servant to God. And that's why in our religion, there are many beautiful names that you can name yourself in Al-Islam, Arabic names for men and women, many beautiful names. But the single best name in Al-Islam, the single best name is to call yourself or your son Abdullah, which means the slave of Allah. And many of the verses of the Quran, they bring this, like Allah called Prophet Muhammad his slave in many verses. Subhanallahi asra bi'abdihi. All praises to Allah, glory to Allah, who took his slave, his servant. So although Muhammad is a prophet and we respect him, nonetheless, he's a human being and he is a servant of Allah. Once the person knows Allah like that, then he'll know himself and he'll know the other people around. So that's freedom, servitude. When a person doesn't make a connection with God who created, he doesn't follow the religion, then that's when he becomes a slave. Now you have to stay with me now. Slavery in Al-Islam. Slavery, the opposite of freedom, slavery in Al-Islam is for a person to put himself in a position where he allows himself to be low because he's like a slave to the system. He's a slave to an idea that harms him. He's a slave to a way of life that is not healthy. I'll give you some examples. Prophet Muhammad mentioned in some words and given this concept, he said, Ta'isa Abdul Dinar. Ta'isa Abdul Dirham. Ta'isa Abdul Khamisa. Ta'isa Abdul Khamila. He will be wretched. He's unhappy. He will be wretched. He will be destroyed. The one who was a slave to the dinar. He is a slave to the dinar. And he gave another example. He is wretched. He's unsuccessful. He's not going to be happy. The one who was a slave to the dirham, another type of currency. The pound, the dollar, the franc. The one who worships money is going to be a slave. He said, he is a slave, he's going to be wretched. The one who's a slave to his clothes. The main thing to him is spending a lot of money on clothes and presenting himself in the public where the people say, oh, ooh, and he'll do anything in that regard. So he called the individual a slave to these particular things. And that's what we have in the society that we're living in right now, where a person is a slave to the credit card. He doesn't have the ability to live within his means, but the society encourages him, and the society is constantly sending out messages to him that you have to keep up with the Joneses, and you have to be a rat in the rat race, and you have to do A, B, and C in order to be considered successful. Freedom is having the nerve and having the gall, being brave enough to think out of the box and to be different and not to let other people make up your mind. People are living right now, and many people believe that by choosing Hillary Clinton or by choosing Donald Trump, Allah forbid, but people actually believe by choosing this one or that one, you are choosing the person who's going to run America and lead America. And that's not the case. Those people don't run America, and they're not the ones who lead America. They're symbols. They're people behind them. There are systems behind them. So the slave is the individual who eats things and he doesn't know why. My wife, who is my queen, the brother asked me, do you want some coffee? Would you like Starbucks? My wife is addicted to this coffee, and I mean it, addicted. I call it crap every time I travel with her. She says to me, hey, can we stop to get some coffee? And it has to be Starbucks. It can't be some regular coffee. Regular coffee doesn't float her boat. I said, okay, we're gonna pull over and we're gonna get your crack. It's expensive, it's overpriced, but when she drinks it, it prevents her from having migraines. When she drinks it, it makes her feel relaxed. Before drinking it, she's muta nervous. That's an Arabic word I'm giving you guys, muta nervous. When she drinks it, she's calm. So I'm always telling her, hey, what's the difference between Costa, Costa, and Starbucks? She said, Abu, wallahi, they're different. I swear by Allah, emphatically, they're different. Can you not taste it? I said, man, they all taste the same to me because I'm not a crackhead. That's why, so it all tastes the same to me. But in her case, and this is the point, my wife is caught up in a game. Now, I use my wife because she's dear to me, she's close. I don't want anyone out there thinking, if you're addicted to Starbucks, that I'm attacking you. I'm not attacking you, this is my wife. If a person really believes, you know, he's a coffee connoisseur, he really can taste this coffee is special, okay, no problem. But come on. I don't know how much this costs in America, because in the UK, this will cost £5, £4. That's about $11, $9. I'm not paying $9 for any coffee. Am I going to do that? So it's the system. And there are many things that are going on in our lives. We don't know why we do things. People hate Islam, and they don't know why. The media made you hate Islam. Yes, some Muslims, they did a lot of bad things. But there are more Christians doing bad things than Muslims because they outnumber the Muslims. Some Muslim countries do some bad things. But when did we Americans, when did our government become the moral authority of the world? That freaks me out when I hear that. So over in the UK, I've been following this guy, Colin Kaepernick, and this silent protest that he's been making, which was his right, it's his right to take a knee. A person is allowed to agree or not agree. But I was really taken aback by the position of some people who were questioning his patriotism and his love for America and so forth and so on. I was shocked at that. The man is doing something that makes a lot of sense. And it's what he believes. He feels that particular symbol, that those words they inculcate and they hold in that Star Spangled Banner, he has a problem with that. I respect that. I mean, come on, even if you don't agree, I respect the man for that. So there's a particular individual who's always coming on Fox News. She was blasting him. I mean, really nasty. And then after that, when Donald Trump said those things that he said, that they brought out those derogatory things, those sexist things that he said about the women. The same lady that was blasting Kaepernick, who was protesting silently because of a symbol, she turned around and was supporting Trump and blasting the people who were against him. And she supported him and she downplayed what he said and what he did. Where this man is not talking about a symbol, he's talking about a human being, a lady. What he said was nasty. And yes, men talk like that. But it's the men who don't have akhlaq and adab, people who don't have good character, they talk like that. That's the speech of the gutter. So the issue here is that type of individual, and I'm not here for Hillary and I'm not here for the other guy. What I'm trying to say is, freedom is having the ability to think and not being an individual who just wants to follow the crowd, an individual who allows people to make your mind up for you. This college, and we have to thank the president of the college and everybody who has something to do with making this possible, sticking to the ethics of the university and the guidelines and the ethos of the university. It's an institution of higher learning. But is it really an institution of higher learning? Because some people go to college only to get debt out of their minds. They have a lot of debt. And you don't really get educated. I don't even want to begin, guys, to tell you as a young man growing up, all of the nonsense that we've been taught, that our heads have been filled up with, all of the nonsense. I grew up liking the cowboy over the Indian, and the cowboy oppressed the Indians. But I grew up liking the cowboy. And I never asked the question why, because of the nonsense that was being drilled into my mind. So freedom in Islam, when a person knows his God, he knows himself, and he knows other people. I give you an example. If that individual were to be told by someone, no, the market is saturated with that type of business that you have a plan to initiate, you'll never be successful in doing that. The person wants to reach high, high, high. Like one of my friends, he comes from Philadelphia. Philadelphia is a tough town, very violent for African Americans. It's a tough town. This one individual, like myself, he went to Medina, and after graduating, he got his master's degree. And then after that, he got his PhD. He's in the process of getting that. He was chosen to teach in the second most important masjid to the Muslims in the whole world. This is a revered person who comes from humble beginnings. His tongue, his language was not Arabic. He embraced the religion like me. He went to the university, started studying. He excelled academically. Got his master's, started to get his PhD. He was chosen to teach in the second holiest masjid for the Muslims around the globe. When the Muslims go there, they see this African-American man teaching in that masjid. I tell you that because, as I tell our community, especially African-American youngsters who are may not have had the best education, and society tells them, you can't do that, you can't do this. Well, that's not true. You can do almost anything that is humanly possible if Allah wants you to do that, if you believe in Allah. That's the meaning of those verses in the Quran, Allah ala kulli shay'in qadir. Allah can do anything that he wants to do. Humanly possible. We're not talking about crazy things. A man just flying without wings, he's just gonna fly. We're not talking about that. We're talking about if you can dream the thing, even if the people don't believe you, you know Allah, so you have faith. I can do it. Inshallah, by Allah's permission. So if you know Allah, you know yourself. And in contrast, if you know Allah, you know yourself, and you know your true limitations. If a person knows Allah, he knows, as a white person, you're not better than black people. As a black person, African-American, I know Allah. So I'm not having an inferiority complex if I walk into a room of a bunch of white people. I don't walk in there apologizing. I don't walk in there feeling like I'm a second-class citizen. But I'm also not going to walk amongst people in an arrogant way neither. Why? Because Allah is the greatest. Why am I arrogant? Allah can destroy me easily. Right now, I don't know what's going on with my children right now. I don't know what's going on with my wife. I'm not in a position to help them. I'm weak. If anything were to happen to them, Allah forbid, I can't do anything. I gotta make a way, I have to find a way to get back to the UK, take care of that situation. So if everything was in my control, at the snap of a finger, the bat of an eye, I'll bring it, I'll make it happen. But I can't do that. So the person who knows God, he knows Allah. He doesn't allow people to put him down, nor does he allow himself to tower over and above the people. Racism. And as a Muslim, we have racist Muslims. We have racist Muslims. Racism is embedded in everyone's society. Sometimes you'll even find the same group of people being racist against each other. Like in the UK, the Brexit issue, the UK exiting the European Union, that has a lot to do with just the British people don't want the Eastern Europeans in their country. Sometimes because they're gonna take all the jobs, that's what they say. But that's not true. The UK is a welfare state, a lot of people just on the welfare. Those Eastern Europeans wanna come in, they wanna work, they wanna take the jobs that the British people don't take. So what's the problem? In Africa, those people, the Tutsis and the Hutus, what country was that? Anybody know? Rwanda. Same group of people, Africans. They neighbors, just different tribes, killing each other. So racism is a problem. And racism comes as a result, a direct result of people not knowing God Almighty. People don't know God. Someone actually exists thinking he's better than someone else based upon his skin. And that's why I always make a lot of supplications for Malcolm X. May Allah have mercy upon him, because he came out of a movement that was extraordinarily racist called the Nation of Islam. They're not Muslims. They just use reverse psychology. They said black people were given Christianity, was forced on us, shoved down our throats. When our forefathers were slaves, the slave master gave us Christianity. He gave us a picture of Jesus Christ, was a white man with blue eyes, blonde hair. He said, this is your God. You're going to be a slave here, but you'll get your pie in the sky when you die. Malcolm X and those people came and said, no, 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 no. Black people are better and white people are devils. So they came with the reverse racism. Both of them are unacceptable. When he left that stuff and he went to Mecca and he met up with Muslims from all over the world, Turkish Muslims, African Muslims, white Muslims from Yugoslavia and all of that, he said, one day, one night, we all went to sleep, they turned the light off, and people were snoring, and I was awake. He said, and I realized, I had an epiphany, and I realized everyone was snoring in the same language, and I could not tell who was white, who was black. Everybody was snoring the same language. And that's the reality of Adam's children, mankind. You get a blood transfusion, your body is not going to reject the blood of a black man or a white man. And your blood is not different from his blood. So the point here is, not to belabor it, but the point here is, if a person knows Allah, he knows God. If he knows him, he knows himself, he knows the people, he is free. He's not going to allow people to push him around. And that's why you find something with the Muslim community around the world. The Muslim community may be subjected, they may be under the yoke of the oppression of an oppressor. And the community doesn't have much. All they have are rocks. They're gonna use those rocks to throw the rocks, because our religion teaches us, don't be a slave to anything that's created. Anything and anyone other than Allah. Now, when I give you that example about throwing rocks and things like that, I don't necessarily support that, because I don't believe that's going to really change your condition. If you have been reduced to throwing rocks at tanks, then Islamically, there's probably some other way to show your protests. But I'm just telling you, those of you who look around the globe and say, how can they do that? And why do they do that? That's one of the reasons. That in Al-Islam, a man who doesn't and he shouldn't tolerate being a slave in any shape, form, or fashion. So freedom in Islam is having a rububiyyah and servitude to Allah. Now, other things I can mention about that, but now I want to go to the issue of oppression. Islam, freedom or oppression. But before that, there's another very important issue, I forgot. And that is, how, if a person is a non-Muslim, he has the freedom to remain a non-Muslim in Al-Islam. And Islam doesn't come and force that individual to become a Muslim. You know this myth, the lie that's been perpetuated so long that people believe it, and that is Islam was spread by the sword. Muhammad, he was killing people, forcing them to become Muslim. I tell you in public, anybody who can bring me proof of that, I'll give him $500, 500 pounds, 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 500. If you can show me any source where Muhammad or his companions killed people and forced them to become Islam. No, you have the freedom not to be a Muslim. Muslims can't compel you if you're living in a Muslim state. If you're married to a Muslim man, there's a verse in the Quran that says, لَا إِكْرَاهَ فِي الدِّينِ قَدْ تَبَيِّنَ الرُّشْدُ مِنَ الْغَيْرِ. There is no compulsion in the religion. You can't compel someone to be a Muslim. Man, you're going to be a Muslim or I'm going to... You can't do that. Al-Islam allowed the Muslim man to marry a Jewish lady or a Christian lady, provided that they're taking care of their, you know, chastity. She has to be chaste. She has to be chaste. If she's a lady that's going out, running around, and sleeping with many men, even if she's a Jewish lady or a Christian lady, she's disqualified. Can't marry that lady. But if she's an upright lady, Christian and Jewish lady, Islam allowed her to marry that lady. And when she married that Muslim, when she marries that Muslim man, she can still eat pork. She can still drink wine and intoxicants. She can still practice Easter and Christmas. All of these holidays that are against Islam. Islam, we don't practice those things because they go against the monotheism of Islam. But that's her religion and that's her way of life. And her husband can't force her. Now, it's not wise for him, in my humble opinion, to put himself in that situation, because if they're in that kind of relationship, there's going to be some clashes sooner or later. And if they have children, it becomes more complicated. But I know some men married to Christian women who have pretty good marriages, to be honest with you. And I know some Muslim men married to Muslim women. Ooh, the marriage is a wreck. It just depends on the dynamics of everybody's peculiar situation. So the point here, the shahid here is, you can't force her. She has the freedom to stay in her religion. And there are many verses, or a few verses of Quran like that. The statement of Allah, where Allah said to Prophet Muhammad, أَفَا أَنْتَ تُكْرِهُ النَّاسِ حَتَّى يَكُونُ مُؤْمِنِينَ. Hey Muhammad, are you going to compel the people and force the people and make them believers? Muhammad never went to the community and he threatened people. I'm going to kill you. Never. It's a lie that people made up. It's one of those things people believe about Islam. It's not true. 500 pounds. You have your smartphones. Look for it right now. That's the difference between 2016 and maybe, you know, 2001 and 1980. A speaker says something, you can look that thing up right now. If you bring me that proof before we leave this place, I'm going to give you 500 pounds. And if I don't, you can say he's a liar in public. 500. Muhammad never did that. And it brings us to the issue of ISIS and people like that. People cut heads off of other people trying to force them into Islam. Those people are not representatives of our religion. And that's the condition of the Muslim community now. The Muslim community, we don't understand our religion that well. A lot of stuff is being pushed off on us, and it's the culture. A lot of things are being pushed off on us, and it's a knee-jerk reaction to the oppression and foreign policies of different Western countries. A lot of things that you see the Muslims doing and believing, they themselves don't know where they come from. And as I told you, when I became a Muslim, the Muslims confused me. I met some people from Pakistan. They were doing some crazy stuff. I said, I'm getting out of here. I met some African Americans. They didn't know what they were doing. They were doing some real crazy stuff. I met another group of people. And as long as I live, I'll never forget. These people, they were from Kenya, originally from India, but they live in Kenya. And I don't know these different groups that the Muslims have, but they had a leader. He was the son of the previous leader who died, so he inherited the leadership of his father, who inherited from his father and his father. I'm the type of person who's going to come and say, why are you the leader? Why can't I be the leader? It's different. YMCA is just your father was the Mulvey Saab, and his father was the Mulvey Saab, and his was the Mulvey. Well, where does that come from? They may not even be religious or qualified. But anyway, this guy, the leader, he was a pretty nice guy, to be honest with you. He was sitting down on a big chair, one of those chairs made out of bamboo. And behind him was a big picture of his father, old man with a white beard, big beard. And we shouldn't even have that type of picture in the masjid. So in order to enter in on him, the whole community of men, we had to start from the door back there, and one by one, you have to crawl on your arms and your knees. You crawl to him, you kiss his feet, you kiss his knee, and then you kiss his ring on his right hand, and then you go about your business. So I was about number 17 in the line. As my turn was coming up, I had trepidation. I was getting nervous, but not nervous, scared, nervous, like, I know I ain't gonna do this. Now what I have to do is I have to manage the drama because I'm not going to do this. I have these complexes, you know, these things in my head. When I travel, like I don't want the police to racially profile me. If they stop me and they, let's say, what's the problem, officer, you racially profiling me? You know, I have that, I'm sensitive like that. When I travel on the airplane, you know, they ask everyone, can you please put your luggage on top of the conveyor belt? We want to weigh it and put it in. Can you put it up? What do you think? I'm a slave. You want me to pick it up? I'm sensitive like that. I don't go that much overboard, but I'm sensitive to people trying to put me down because that's been my experience as an African American. That's who I am. So in this case, as I started to get to the front of the line, I decided I'm not doing that. And I was a brand spanking new Muslim. I had about a month in Islam. I said, I'm not doing that. So I just walked to the man and I shook his hand and I went the other way. When I met up with the other ones who had preceded me, they were sucking their tongue. They were going. But I didn't care about that because I'm not crawling to no human being. And then as time went on, I learned and I realized what I did was Islamic because it was just the natural disposition of the human being. Don't do something like that. Don't do something like that. So as it relates to this freedom of al-Islam, freedom is servitude. Freedom is not saying and doing anything that you want to do, eating anything, wearing anything. That's not freedom in al-Islam. That's slavery. That is slavery. But Islam did give the non-Muslim the freedom to not embrace Islam, have that freedom. Those verses are there. Second issue before we go to oppression, inshallah, is there are some verses that some Muslims use to show that the Muslim has the right and the freedom to leave Islam. I say, no, you don't have the right to leave Islam. I think many of you non-Muslims may be aware that there's corporal punishment, capital punishment in the Muslim world, in al-Islam. If you apostate, the recompense and the penalty for that is corporal punishment. And there are many reasons for that. So no, you don't have to, and I don't hide behind anything in this religion, from alif to get A to Z, I believe everything in Islam. Everything has a plausible explanation. You may know it, you may not know it, but I'm not one of those people who hide behind things because people can't understand it or people can't embrace it. I'm not the one who legislated in this religion. I just embraced it, I believe in it, I'll do my best to try to explain, but I won't manipulate the religion. I won't change the meanings of things. So in al-Islam, there's some harsh penalties for certain crimes that are committed, some harsh penalties, and this is one of the harsh penalties. So some Muslims who are apologetic, who are very modern, and again, I told you, Prophet Muhammad, the Quran, it is what determines and defines things, not the people, because look, a terrorist to some people is a freedom fighter to other people. I don't know if you people are aware of what happened recently with the CEO of Wells Fargo, that bank, the CEO. He stole tens of millions of dollars. I think it was $100 million. He stole it from the people. Stole $100 million. Some astronomical amount of money he stole. And only they were slapped him on his wrist. He sat before the Senate. Some of the senators were upset with him. They were saying, you need to be jailed. But it was just rhetoric. And you could see the way he was smirking, that he just couldn't wait to get back to his mansion or fly his jet plane. You could just see, he just knew it was a joke. Now, when he took $100 million, he got his severance pay and a slap on the wrist, paid some of the money back, go about your business. Whereas the guy who's working for Starbucks, he slips $20 in his pocket. They say that he stole the $20. He's a criminal. But the guy from Wells Fargo, he's a capitalist. That's capitalism, what he did. So people's interpretations of things are different. It's different. So one person says modernity is walking naked. I say, no, that's uncivilized. That's not modernity. So people's interpretations and definitions of things are different. In Al-Islam, we cut through all of that stuff. Prophet Muhammad, the Quran, they are the ones who define for us how we understand this, how we understand that. And don't misunderstand Muslim, non-Muslim. That doesn't mean that you're in a straight jacket and you can't move around in Islam. It doesn't mean that. It means the more knowledge you get about your religion, the more flexibility you'll have. The less you know, the more confused, the more problems you're going to incur. So some of these apologetic modern Muslims, they took some verses out of context about freedom. They're the verse in one of the shortest surahs, Surah Al-Kafirun, Qul Ya Ayyuhal Kafirun. In that surah is a statement, لَكُمْ دِينُكُمْ وَلِيَ دِينُ. The ayah said that the Muslim says to them, to you is your religion, your way of life, and to me is mine. Another one is the statement, فَمَنْ شَاءَ فَلْيُؤْمِنْ وَمَنْ شَاءَ فَلْيَكْفُرْ. Whoever wants to believe, let him believe. Whoever wants to disbelieve, let him disbelieve. So these apologetic Muslims said that these verses mean, as a Muslim, the ayat is saying, you can leave Islam, you can disbelieve. But that's not the meaning of that verse. And I wanted to say that for clarification. The verse, لَكُمْ دِينَكُمْ وَلِيَدِينَ, is a verse talking about al-wala wal-bara, allegiance, enmity and allegiance. And this ayah is making al-bara from kufr, and from the people of kufr. The other ayah, whoever wants to believe, let him believe, whoever wants to disbelieve, let him disbelieve. That's a verse of wa'id and tahdeed. I don't know, how would you translate that? Wa'id and tahdeed. A threat. It's like the person who says, your boss at your job, your mother, your father, the husband, someone in authority says to someone else, okay, you go ahead, do what you want to do. Do what you want to do. He's not giving you the green light to go and do what you want to do. He's threatening you, meaning if you go and do it, there's a price to pay. It's a threat. Okay, you go ahead, do what you want to do. The one who hears that doesn't understand he can go ahead and write on the walls. He understands from that he's threatening him. Don't do what I don't want you to do. That's the meaning of those verses. So I'm mentioning that to the Muslims specifically here because, again, we're living in tumultuous times. The leaders of the Muslims, people were teaching our community. Islam during this time is strange. Prophet Muhammad comes back right now. If that was possible, he wouldn't recognize a lot about this religion. Muslims believe that Jesus is going to come back, the Messiah. Gotta believe that as a Muslim. Jesus will come back and he's going to rectify things because the community, it's confusion, compounded confusion. So you guys who are studying in these institutions of higher learning and you are educated people, that's another relative term, educated. You're educated people. Islam shouldn't be embraced by you the way your fathers did and your forefathers, where your religion just becomes, well, that's what my mother and my father did. Why are you doing that? That's what my mother and my father did. And who said that your mother and father knew what they were doing? You guys have to use that ni'mah that Allah blessed you. Use your intellect to practice and learn the religion. Lastly, the second half, oppression. Freedom or oppression. There's limited freedom in Islam, and freedom is serving Allah and doing what He told you to do. And slavery is not worshiping God and not doing the things that He told you to do. You become, as a result of that, a slave to whatever your vice is. Oppression. Listen to me, because this is real easy and it's short. And Islam is going this way, and oppression is going the other way, diametrically opposed. In no shape, form, or fashion is oppression allowed in Islam. Two wrongs don't make a right in this religion. Like in the UK, we have a lot of extreme and radical youngsters there, worse than what is here in America. So they look at the foreign policy of the UK, look at the foreign policy of America, the lopsided nature of how America deals with the Yahud, the Jews, and stuff like that, and all of these things that are going on. So the youngsters want to go because of see what's happening to their brothers, so this is wrong what they're doing. But you doing something wrong doesn't rectify that problem. Islam doesn't allow you to do that. And many of those things happened during Prophet Muhammad's time, where his companions were being persecuted, they were being killed. And he didn't let his companions do things that they wanted to do when the people were in a position of weakness, like the weak men, the older people and the women. They were there and they could have pounced upon him. He said, you can't do that. It's not our religion. Because the strong people from them were oppressing us, we're going to now take this opportunity. You can't do that in our religion. So there is no, absolutely no place for oppression in the religion. Our religion is a religion that's easy, it makes sense. It's a religion that's intellectual. It's not a religion of confusion. Confusion. What we see today is a lot of confusion that's taking place. A lot of confusion. But if you just knew the basics of Islam, you realize that when it comes to this issue of oppression, Allah doesn't oppress His servants. And He made oppression impermissible for us to oppress one another. Allah is a God who doesn't oppress. So when we see things happening around the globe where it appears the weak and the defenseless are being oppressed, we don't say that God is doing that. There's some wisdom why He's allowing that, but it doesn't mean that that's something that's okay. There's some wisdom. Whether we understand it or don't understand it, there is some wisdom in that. But we don't believe that Allah is oppressive, and because He doesn't oppress, He doesn't allow it in the religion of Islam. So now, if the one who comes into the religion, when he embraces Islam, he doesn't say, like in Ramadan, this last Ramadan a few months ago, 4 months ago, we fast for 30 days. It's one of the five pillars of Islam, is to fast in the month of Ramadan. In the UK, we were fasting 18 and a half hours every day. Because you fast from sunup to sundown. So depending upon where you are in the world, and depending upon what year it is, the days can be longer or shorter. We're dealing with some very long days right now. 18 and a half hours. Norway was even longer than that. So when I first became a Muslim, fasting was short, because I became a Muslim in the month of Ramadan. And when I became a Muslim, I never fasted in my life. And when I was fasting, I was saying, man, this is hard. This is hard. I almost backed up from Islam because of fasting, because I wasn't used to it. I said, this is difficult. But I had people around me who knew what they were doing, and they helped me through it. It's always important to have it. So as a Muslim, I can't say fasting 18 and a half hours, God is oppressive. Why would He do that? It's too hard. It's too... No. We went through that whole month, 30 days, and now those days are behind us, and it's done. We did it, we managed it, it's something we proved, you can do it. Without undue stress and duress, you can handle it. And the person who can't handle that, then the religion gave him a concession. It's too difficult for you, you're too old, you're sick, then you don't have to fast. So oppression, there is no way, no equation. There is nothing someone can bring, an example, to the table where oppression is acceptable, it's valid. No one can do that. All forms and all strands of oppression, not permissible in this religion, from the beginning to the end. So I come to this issue of the Muslim woman. Is she oppressed? Is she oppressed? Well, for the one who doesn't know about Islam, and the one who didn't study about Islam, but they're looking at Islam from the outside, and they want to superimpose what they understand upon the Muslim woman because she dresses the way she dresses. That's not fair. Because I think if she were to look at the lady who's walking around and all of her goods are out, and the one wanted to just say, this is just an example, guys. I don't mean this, this is an example. But how would you feel? How would one of you feel? If you walk by a group of people and they say, such a slut, and they use that type of language, that's not acceptable to describe people like that and to talk to people like that. Okay, well, let's put the shoe on the other foot. You have some empathy, have some sympathy. Put yourself in the shoes of that lady, that Muslim lady, who people look at her and they say, oh, that poor girl, she's so backwards and so oppressed. And she's a free thinker. She doesn't have a problem with that. Why are you being so judgmental like that? And you would never accept for the people to say what they can say about you. And you may not be a slut. That's just the way you dress, because that's the society you live in, and that's what we do in this weather. You're not a slut. She's not a slut. She's a real good person, actually. But people, when they watch her, that's how they describe her, with that venom. It's not nice. It's not right. As a Muslim, that language is not right. I don't condone that language. I don't think what she's doing is respecting herself. I think she's more than that. The one who created her wants more from her than that. He wants people to look at her mind first. He wants people to get to know her spirit first. Not when the man looks at her, he just wants that one thing. And now she has relationship after relationship after relationship. And part of that is because she's caught up into that way of not knowing how to think for yourself. So the point is the Muslim woman oppressed? Yes, some Muslim women are oppressed because of the culture. She's forced into a marriage. That's crazy. That's oppression. That's not our religion. She's oppressed because some of the men of her family, they don't want to encourage her to excel academically. But those are the people in her family. It's for the religion of Islam, it didn't say that. The religion of Islam encouraged her to get educated, but to stay within the boundaries of the religion, to stay within the demarcation of Islam. Islam put a lot of value on education, having an educated. I want a wife who's not educated. I don't want a woman who can't educate my children. Who wants that? But in terms of the Muslim woman wearing this hijab, one person's terrorist is another person's freedom fighter. One person sees her as being oppressed, another person sees her as being a jewel, a precious stone, as being covered. Her beauty is being covered, and it's not for everybody. And when you meet her, you're gonna meet her mind first. You're gonna meet her spirit. You're gonna get a feel for who she is, the content of her character, and not just what she's bringing physically to the table. Can't conduct and hold a decent relationship with another man except that his eyes are wandering all over the place and he can't really talk to you, get to know you. So no, she's not oppressed in that regard. And the people who are not Muslims, I say, guys, you have to open up your minds a little bit more to this thing about who made us Americans, or where the West, who made us the moral compass for everybody else? Who did that? And I hope during the Q&A session, maybe someone's going to let me know who did that, and we can, you know, have a further discussion. But as it relates to oppression of Islam in all shapes, forms, and fashion, it has been condemned, it's not condoned, and no one can bring any examples where oppression is allowed. Where? When it comes to freedom, we have to explain that. No, you're not free to do any and everything. You're not free to do any. And the meaning of freedom in Islam is this, but it's limited. So with that, guys, we'll bring this session to a close. And if you guys have any questions about what was said, we'll be more than happy to do our best, inshallah, to try to answer your questions.
Jazallah khair, Shaykhana Abu Usama. We thank you for this beautiful lecture. Let's go ahead and bring the questions. Like I said, the Shaykh is coming from the UK, and he's been all around the world in New Jersey, so you will not offend him with any question you have.
So that's not that true, man. If somebody got up and asked me, Abu, how did your wife's hair look? It's the texture of her hair. I'm gonna jump over the chairs. I'm gonna be offended. No, go ahead.
Okay, Zakallah. So he will not be offended unless you reach his borders and his demarcations. So any questions? Come on, bring them. San Diego State, man. Let him go back to
you. Especially extra credit people. I was shocked when I heard that some of you are here to get extra credit. Wow.
It's been pretty clear to me, being exposed to like American media, like the kind of picture that's trying to be painted of Islam and Muslims like around the world. But being like with your experience in the UK, can you just kind of describe that more in terms of not necessarily just the media's portrayal of Islam, but like what does it look like to not be in America in what is your experience?
It's an interesting question, man, because the UK, they are far more tolerant than in America. As a matter of fact, I would even go as far as to say that the UK is the most tolerant European country on the face of the earth as it relates to Muslims. And the Muslims who come to the UK from France, from Italy, who come from Germany, and these other places, it is, you know, a hands down argument. The UK is extremely tolerant. But the UK is a bit of an enigma. It's a bit difficult to understand, because although that is the case, at the same time, some of the people there, the government there, the people, the culture, they still have that British Empire mentality. The British Empire is the place where the sun never sets. This is how we civilize the world. Some of the people are like that. My wife is from Africa, but she dresses in black. She was in the shopping mall, and a lady told my wife, who's from Africa, "You need to go back to Iran." My wife has nothing to do with Iran. My wife is from Africa. But that's the ignorance of that lady. And they have this thing where they look at people like they're better than you if you are of color, from India, from Pakistan, if you've come from Africa. But as I told you, government opens up its doors and its borders to take in a lot of people. So some of the people who voted to get out of the European Union, they did have a legitimate point, because the immigration problem is overwhelming the way it has been. As it relates to the Muslims and the media, the British government is like the American government, the American media. It's the same thing, the same coin, but a different side. One man, his name is Rupert Murdoch, he owns most of the media apparatus is there. And he's the buddy to all of the politicians, the prime minister previously, the one now, they're the godfathers of each other. And, you know, they have their secret meetings about, and I'm not a conspiracy theorist, but this is reality. So whenever something happens, and I remember when I first moved to England, when I first lived there 15 years ago or something like that, Timothy McVeigh, who blew up that building in Oklahoma, remember that guy, he blew up the building. He was a racist, white supremacist. Some serious bombs he had blew up the face of the building. It's a nursery and some children got it. The next day in the UK, one of the main newspapers, there was a picture of a fireman carrying a lifeless body of one of the children. If a picture ever spoke a thousand words, this was the picture. The kid's body was just lifeless, like that Syrian kid that was in the water. You guys saw that Syrian kid that drowned? The imagery is still in our minds. May Allah protect our children and the Syrian kids as well. The caption of that picture said, Islamic terrorism. And he was a white supremacist. And that's what happens now. Every time something happens, like what happened in Orlando recently, when they report it, they say Islamic terrorism. The guy is gay. And you can be a Muslim and gay, meaning being a homosexual, being a lesbian, doesn't expel you from Islam, but it's a sin. The guy was gay, he was partying, he had nothing to do with Islam, he wasn't doing that in the name of Islam, but it's always Islamic terrorism, Islamic terrorism. So a few months ago, another racist, white supremacist, he shot a very good member of parliament. A lady, a white lady, who had, she did a lot of things for her constituency. I mean, she traveled to Africa, she did a lot of aid work. This guy walked up to a man and shot him in the head and stabbed him. And instead of saying white supremacists or something like that, Christian terrorism or something like that, they explained it away. It was a big thing, but they wrote, he had mental problems. He had mental problems. The revert guy was originally from Nigeria. He embraced Islam. He was ignorant. He doesn't know his religion. They went to that soldier's name was Lee Rigby, the UK. Ran him over with a car, took the butcher's knife out, stabbed him up, chopped him up with an axe. And instead of running, not that I condone that, but a normal person would try to get away after committing a crime like that. Instead of running, they stood there and gave interviews. This is Islam, the Khilafah is coming, and this is, who does that? Who in his right mind does that? So when he did all of that, Islamic terrorism, that guy doesn't speak for Islam. That's not our religion. So this is what we have in the UK. It's terrible. I'm talking about it's terrible because it's blatant now. They have a thing called prevent. Prevent. They're trying to figure out how do we stop Islamic extremism? How do we stop Muslim kids from being extreme? Well, you can start by shouldering and acknowledging some of the responsibility that you have in your foreign policy. You killed tens of millions of Muslims around the globe. They don't want to say that. They want me as the imam to just condemn the Muslims, condemn them. No, I'll do that. But I'm also going to call a spade and have something to do with it. You're cutting the legs from under people like me. Can't keep these kids grounded and you're killing them, brothers. Come on, you have something to do with that. But anyway, prevent. This is outrageous. It's targeting the Muslims only, the Muslim children. So the teachers and these doctors and professionals, they take about 4 hours of some training to look for signs of extremism. And once they see the signs only in the Muslim kids, they report it to the police. So they had some real crazy situations that happened, like a young kid, when the teacher was asking the kids about what you did over the weekend, the kid said that my father was cooking, my father made a cooker bomb. A cooker bomb, little kid. He was like 6, 7. My father made a cooker bomb. He meant to say my father made a cucumber, but he called it a cucumber. It was the responsibility of the teacher to use some discretion. I don't know about you guys, but I had some teachers that I really liked when I was young. So if I raise my hand, sometimes I would say to the teacher, Ema, Ema, call her by my mother, because I liked her. Under the prevent, if I say that, hey, Ma, hey, Ma, that's a sign I'm being abused at home. No, you have to use your discretion. I like you. That's why I mean that I confuse you with my mother just in my language. So another guy, a kid, they have a thing there called World Book Day. And that's a case where the kids come to school and you have to dress up like some character out of a book. So the Muslim guy dressed up with a turban, with a, you know, like a Muslim from a long time ago. So the teacher said, you're Aladdin, Aladdin, Alauddin, you're Aladdin. The kid said, no, I'm not Aladdin. Aladdin was a thief. Because the story, he steals, Aladdin steals. He said, Aladdin is a thief. I'm not Aladdin. She said, who are you then? She said, I'm Salahuddin. He said, I'm Salahuddin al-Ayyubi. And Salahuddin al-Ayyubi was a very powerful man that helped to conquer the Crusaders and take Palestine and Jerusalem and give it back to the Muslims. So when he said that, they wrote him up as being an extremist. And there are many situations like that. They asked another kid, describe your house. He said, I live in a terrorist house. He meant to say a terrace, T-E-R-R-A-C-E. But because he's so young, he said terrorist. And it's that bad. I'm not making this stuff up. And it's only with the Muslims, only with the Muslims. So from that angle, we have a lot of challenges in the UK. But it's much better than America, I believe. I think it's much better. It's just that the media is a big problem over there. Next question.
Any questions?
I'll start walking around. Is there a microwave out there?
You mentioned that you converted to the religion. You weren't born into it. Your parents were Christian, I think you said. So I can imagine that there are some difficulties, like you said, with fasting. That was difficult for you. But what other difficulties did you come across, still to this day, do you come across as far as practicing religion?
Certain difficulties. The nature of Islam is not difficult to practice, provided you know what you're doing. The more you know, the easier it is to practice. When you don't know what you're doing, it's a bit of a problem. So at the beginning, I was like being more like a pirate, being more like a monkey. I was mimicking what people were doing. So when they were praying, I was just moving as they were moving, but I wasn't feeling the essence of what I'm doing, because at that time, I'm just following these people. But as the days passed and they grew into months, and the months grew into years, and I went and I studied, you get over those hurdles. Many reverts who I know have this other problem of their families. I didn't have a problem with my family. My family, very supportive. They compared how I was before Islam to how I became after Islam, so they were more than happy. And to this day, they're very supportive. But my extended family members and some people from my community, although the vast majority of them accept me for who I am and how I am and the change that I've made, but many revert people, they have that problem, especially if they come into the religion with too much fervor, unbridled excitement. So there are things that, in the religion, for example, in Islam, there are things that, how I'd say, the picture of the guy shouldn't be in your house like that. So maybe an individual embraces Islam, and in his mother's house, She has a cabinet full of alcohol, vodka and gin and all of that stuff. So if he doesn't have knowledge, he'll go and he'll take that stuff and he'll throw it away. $250, $300 worth of vodka and wine, and maybe pull some expensive wine away. That's not how you deal with them. That's their house, first of all. And you don't do things like that to alienate them. They're gonna think you're crazy. And I know many people who have gone through that. That's why it's really important for a new revert to be around people who are balanced. Don't be around those Muslims who are not balanced. The lady comes to Islam. The other sister says, you gotta get married. She said, damn, I just became a Muslim yesterday. Maybe I gotta get married. I just became a Muslim yesterday. And they put pressure on her. And she wants to do the right thing. So she follows with them. No, don't be like that. Be free to think. And then when it's time to get married, any suitor that comes, you know, before Islam, you had nothing in common with a person who is horizontally challenged, you know, a person who's a short person. But they bring that person to you and you say, well, you know, before Islam, I would never bring that. I'm not prejudiced or anything, but this is not what I'm. So, you know, you gotta love them for Allah. Love them for Allah. And due to lack of experience and knowledge, she does that, makes that decision. That's an extreme example. But things like that happen left, right, and center. So it's really important for the revert to be around balanced people. You come to the religion, there are people who want to blow things up, they want to kill people, and your brain's making a Muslim, that can affect you. So when you hear people saying crazy things, you have to have enough sense to get away from crazy people. So I personally didn't have that many problems. My problem was really in trying to find the right path. The Muslims were not and are not given a good example of the Islam that Prophet Muhammad brought, the Quran and the Sunnah, and the way his companions understood that Quran and the Sunnah. The Muslims are doing a lot of crazy things right now, and that's just how it is. And I'm not going to put down my own, you know, hang up our dirty laundry out in public. I'm not going to do that. But I have to say it how it is on the surface. And I say that to all of you, for the most part, the masajid that we have, the people who are educating us, ourselves, we have to do a better job with learning this religion, learning it so we can practice it the right way. What's your name, man? After this thing, I want to talk to you, okay, real quick. Any more questions, guys? You extra credit people, any more questions?
Okay, so you talked about freedom. You mentioned that our strength in our religion is the ability to control ourselves. Can you go more into that?
Say it again.
You mentioned how, like, the strength in the religion is the ability to control, like, yourselves.
To control yourself, yeah. The hadith, again, as I was mentioning to you guys, is that the strong one is the one who is not necessarily bringing to the table physicality. This is what we think in a society, that the strong one is the one with the muscles. He's the strong one. The strong one is the one who has the ability to control himself. I'll give you an example. A person is in a relationship that's dysfunctional. It's not healthy. They are devoted. They have love for their partner, but there's no reciprocity. That person is willing to give their all for the other person. They're always thinking about them first, their comfort, their safety, what they like, what they don't like, before themselves. And it's natural because they're committed to that person. And that person has a history of breaking their heart, abusing them, physically, mentally, emotionally, as a history. Multiple relationships outside of that partner. And the one who's going through that doesn't have the ability to say, hey, enough is enough. I love myself enough to say, this is it. Because this rhetoric, you love me, that stuff gets stale when it wears out. If you really love me, the proof is in the pudding. Show me that in your behavior. That's a strong person. The weak person, and I'm not judging because I fear, I feel for that person. They need support, they need understanding. And why do people do that? Who knows? But the one who tolerates that and allows it and makes excuses and they take it day in and day out, that's a sign of weakness. Sign, and the guy can have all the muscles in the world, or the girl in that situation can be extremely athletic, has a gold medal, won a gold medal in swimming or whatever, ran a marathon or whatever, but they can't get out of that relationship. Having that inner strength again, where like over there in the UK, there's a big thing about bullying. You know, these kids are committing suicide because of bullying. It's not something I can relate to, because I never was bullied. But I do know I used to try to help people who were bullied growing up. So I can't really relate to that. How someone bullies you and then you go home and strangle yourself, hang yourself. So in addressing this, in our community, we have to impart knowledge to these kids that, hey, you are, don't be one of those people who are, you can't speak out for yourself. Don't be one of those people that allow people to oppress you. So I think in our religion, we have apparatuses that are naturally built in to make people like learn these lessons and practice them. But in many instances, like Muslims are not perfect. Some people get the memo, some people don't. So strength is not being able to, real strength is not being able to carry the table from day to day. Not being able to do that. Strong, being strong, like you ask a question in front of everybody. You want to know, so you ask a question. There's a person there in the audience, they have some questions, but they're not going to ask because, hey, I'm too shy and I don't want to be on Front Street like that. So that's the meaning of the verse. That's the meaning of that incident, having inner strength. Here's another strong one. She got the strength from the partner next to her, huh?
So you gave the example of, I believe it was your wife, who was told to go back to Iraq.
Yeah, my wife was told to go back to Iran, and the religion of the Iranians is not even the religion of my wife as well.
Let's say that somebody told that to you. How would you respond to that situation?
It's funny that you would mention that, because in the UK, on the bus, there was a lady from Jamaica who was on the bus. An Arab Muslim lady got on the bus with a pram, baby carriage, and she had a baby on her back. And the Jamaican lady was speaking that patois that Jamaicans speak. And she was very threatening and menacing. She was saying to the Muslim lady, "You whore, go, you Muslim whore, you terrorist, go back to where you came from." And she was verbally abusing her. And people recorded it. And that lady got in trouble. When I saw it, I was shocked. I was shocked because she came from Jamaica. She was from Africa, then taken to Jamaica. Now she's in the UK. And she's telling someone else, "Go back to where you come from." So that's the same verbal abuse that she was hearing from white people, so now she's giving it to someone. I just couldn't understand that. I couldn't understand it. So I think if I was unfortunate to have met someone like that, in trying to be strong, I wouldn't lash out violently and physically, but I would say, what is the reality in the UK? The reality in the UK, just as it is the reality in America, everybody came from somewhere else. Everybody here came from somewhere. These white people, they came from somewhere else. Everybody has something in them. Got Irish in them, Scottish, everybody's mixed with something. And then we have to look at You know, if you really want to say that, the original inhabitants of America were the Native Americans. Same thing over there in the UK. Everybody came from someone. So with the mass migration that's going on in the world, I came from Holland recently. Holland is a beautiful place. A lot of different people are there. But there's some there's blatant racism in there. Despite the fact that everybody's diverse and different. So some people just want to be stuck on stupid and they want to be ignorant and they look at people like that. And I think that's a shame because we have more in common than what we don't have in common. You just have to get rid of that ignorance of being afraid of what you don't know. That's what xenophobia is. You're afraid of someone who comes from somewhere else. Why are you afraid of them? Because I just don't know him. Well, take the time out to get to know him and to celebrate the differences that we have. Because in meeting you, I'm going to learn about your culture. I'm going to learn about where you came from, your people, your foods. And I'm going to share that with you. And when our orbits, you know, cross like that, we become more enriched. But that's what enlightened people, intelligent people think like that. It's the ignorant races, whether you're black, white, man, woman, rich, poor. They're the ones who judge people, look at people based upon. Some people, if they see a beard, they don't like the person. They think has a bomb. If you ever go to the London Underground subway with a bag on you, your student, people think you have a bomb. They don't want to sit next to you. But I do understand that. I understand that. So, you know, we want to open our minds and celebrate our differences. Hey, if you don't mind, where are you guys from? YouTube, where are you from?
I'm from Eritrea.
Yeah. And your friend?
Oh, I'm like city or?
Like originally, like your parents come from somewhere else.
My dad is black and my mom's Mexican.
Your mom is what?
Mexican.
Pakistani.
No, Mexican.
Yeah. Okay. Just trying to get to know you guys a little more, that's all. Don't want to put you on the spot. It's a cool mix. Any more questions, guys? Okay then. There are no more questions. We're going to call it a day.
أحسن قولا ممن دعا إلى الله وعمل صالحا.